Omni Expo, which is in Florida, May 22nd through 24th, and I was like, let's go all out. So I had some wonderful cosplayers take pity on me, and I think they did a pretty good job. Yeah? Hey, you guys. Ohayo, guys. Hi, so anyway, so I'm Jessica Calvello, and introduce yourselves, Mother Effers.
Hi, I'm Rob Mungle. How are you? Outstanding.
I'm Cynthia Martinez. Can we cuss in this panel?
Can we? Is this PG-13? No? But you're leaving. What do you care?
Yeah.
I'm just kidding. I want
to play. We're just playing. We love you.
Just kidding.
She's gone.
If people weren't putting it up on YouTube, then maybe.
Oh, it's YouTube. All right. Yeah. This table, like, hi, I can barely see you over this table. We'll fix that.
We're going to rearrange furniture.
When Mexicans go to restaurants, we always have to put tables together. Oh, I can say that. I'm Mexican. It's okay.
Yay! So we don't have a plan. I mean, we usually don't. But I guess this is just a regular Q&A for Excel Saga. You guys Excel Saga fans?
Yeah!
Anime on crack, crack on anime, right? So this is actually, so Rob and I have been doing voice work together since like 95.
Easily, yeah.
Yeah, my first show was in 95 with ADD Films, and I think it was Evangelion. I had three lines in the Evangelion. One of them was, "The doors are now closing." And then I went on to do other stuff. But the first time I'm meeting Rob is actually right now, which is pretty crazy.
Yeah, well, we met last night.
But no one remembers that, so it's right now.
We want to forget that, actually. So just know I'm meeting him now. So, yeah.
It's lovely to meet you.
Likewise. Stop touching me. Or start touching me. PG-13, there's no touching. So, that's my pathetic intro. How long have you been with the VA world, Rob?
I started in 1994. Jesus, that's a little, most of y'all were born then.
God, you're
We did something that was released on VHS, that's how long ago.
Yes.
VHS, yeah. It was. I still have it. It was Guy the Double Target. Anyone? Anyone? No.
What was the Double Target?
I don't have the foggiest idea.
I can imagine.
But I started, I do stand-up comedy, and one of the guys from ADV who ran the place came to see my show, and he said, "Hey, you'd be good at this." And so I did it, and I've been doing it ever since.
Awesome.
I played Pedro in Excel Song.
My tears are blowing like waterfalls.
How's the universe been treating you?
I'm Cynthia Martinez, and I've been voice acting, I guess, since 98. So I started voice acting. I actually was singing and writing, and somebody said that I sounded like a cartoon character, so I went into this open call and got cast for the first show ever that I ever did with Slayers and Lena Inverse, which I didn't know then was as big as she is, and so that was my introduction to anime, that was my introduction to voice work, and I play Excel Kobayashi in Excel Saga. I just want to be Jessica. So whatever she says, I'm going to do here.
Oh boy.
And then Robbie, we spinned off and did Puni Puni Poemi, which I was told was banned in Australia last night, and it's banned in New Zealand. So if you try to sneak in Puni Puni Poemi, I don't know, there's a bondage scene or something?
Australia has a...
I'm a rapper. yeah, it's like $10,000 to sneak in Puni Puni Poemi, so let's try that. It's a federal offense.
$10,000?
Yes, something weird like that.
That makes sense.
I don't know.
Why would they have such, like, crazy animals? Why would they care about a bondage scene? Because there's a connection there in my mind.
I know. That's what I was thinking. It's
just
true.
Right, keep going. Skip it.
Pretend you didn't hear that. Let's go on. Anything else?
They have kangaroos. Why don't they have bondage?
I'm just saying.
It makes sense.
What's wrong with those people?
They have hyenas as pets. Why not have
them?
like VHS.
Yeah. So like, I don't know, but tell me if this is your experience. So like, whenever you know Matt or whoever would call, you know, call you for a role, he'd be like, "So we want you to study it first. So come by the studio, pick up the VHS tapes and the scripts, because we used paper back then. I know you guys don't know what paper is now. Obsolete, but we used paper back then. And
some of us still use papyrus, thank you.
I love papyrus.
I do too.
So I would literally, I'd drive to the studio, I'd pick up a VHS tape, which only could hold 2 episodes. So if it was like Cutie Honey, it was an 8-episode series, I had to pick up 4 VHS tapes. Wait, is that the right math? 2, 2, 2, 2? I can't math. But yeah, so 4 VHS tapes, 2 episodes on each, you know, 8 scripts, and he wanted me to study the flaps in the dub, that way when I went into the studio, I'd hit the sync perfectly, because we would go like 5 lines an hour, whereas now you're like 80 plus lines an hour, because everything's digital, and it's just easier and faster. Did you guys ever have to study?
They gave it to me. I never watched any of it.
I think they don't let me study.
Really?
Yeah. Was it a Mexican thing? Yeah. Like, she's Mexican.
They trusted you because you were Mexican. Maybe that was it.
They only wanted me as little as they could possibly get me in there.
Yeah, they would give it to me and they would say, okay, this is Carrie's backstory, and you have to understand. Like, okay, whatever.
See, okay, wait a minute.
I'm coming over and you're going to pay me $100 and talk to a microphone. All right, fine, let's do it.
I would walk in and they'd be like, you're 16 today. Okay, wait, y'all got to study?
I did. I felt like I had to. I'd be fired. I would get stressed out about it. I have like all my VHS tapes and I'm on the floor of my like, tiny apartment and I'm like writing, making notes. 2 flaps short, flap and a half too long. Flaps meaning lip flaps, not... Moving on. So
that's funny.
Yeah. So anyway, do you guys have any Q&A or?
Yeah. Sure.
Do you guys have questions about Excel?
Oh, she's anxious.
This is kind of a more ADD question. ADD is a little more liberal. Some of their translations of things like colorful and Belchan.
Yeah. I was in Belchan.
Yeah. How did that translate? How did that translate to a working environment versus some of the other?
What do you mean? Because the translation was loose,
or just because they did their own like live action bits and their own translations and things, and their own, they even did their own dubbing of the songs in certain ones.
Yeah.
Okay.
I don't know. It just depends on where you go. I mean, it's half dozen to one. You know.
I mean, AAB was famous for that, and I pulled it off probably the best of anyone I've seen.
A lot of that was Stephen Foster. He was behind a lot of that. But no, it's not any different than anything else. I mean, I've worked at other places and some are more rigid, shall we say, and that's not as fun, but you know, I don't care. Do I get paid? I don't care. If you're gonna give me a check, I'll do whatever you want. I'll tap dance.
Wow.
Literally.
You know, in Australia, they have animals and bondage. Maybe you do well there.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Does that answer your question, Tom?
Why do you think the
world
of the universe is so sexy?
Are you asking me, Frog?
Yeah.
The great will of the macrocosm?
Yeah.
Is, you know, those are some sexy legs. With the high heels, right? So much to do, so little time. That was Kelly Madison, I think. I don't know, but I like them. I mean, if you're going to have a world with legs, why not make them sexy? Right?
Yeah. The guy who drew it was really horny.
All the time.
And light legs, that answers.
And boobies.
Yeah.
We all do, though, right? This is PG-13. This is science. Please have a question.
What was your first impression of the show? Your first impression? Geez.
I thought whoever did it was on acid. A lot of acid.
It moves so fast. I mean, you're just kind of like, what is going on? It was hard to grasp. I had nightmares. And fast forward.
I was scared. And I heard that the original VA, the Seiyu, Kotona Mitsubishi, that she was so, she's amazing. And she actually, at one point, just threw the script up in the air and just started ad-libbing. Because her dialogue is, what is that? I mean, and that's not, some of it actually wasn't translatable. On the script, there's some areas where it's like, not translatable. And I'm like, Matt, what would you like me to say here? And he's like, say whatever, it's not translatable. So a lot of what I did was, ah, you know, it was crazy too, and not translatable. It's say that 5 more times.
Here's a fun thing. If you actually watch it on acid, it's completely it's coherent. So, it's actually a beautiful story.
It's a fun
story. It's touching.
Do acid.
Yeah. Oh, and stay in school, kids. Yeah. Don't do acid. Your drugs are bad, apparently.
Yeah, this is less about the show, but more about your experience since you've all been in the industry a long time. Do you find, since they do so much digital now, do you find that they do a lot of different types of things with the voices now that you record in terms of enhancing, or is what we hear pretty much you?
It's pretty much, yeah. There's a touch of it every now and then if they have to do something that's, you know, if they need something like this, then they have like a demon or something, then they can add an effect to it. But 90% of it is what we do.
They're pretty, they tend to use a lot more compression than they used to. So if the line's just like one half flap too much, they'll compress a little bit or they'll stretch it. I don't know what the word for stretching is. I just know the word for shrinking is compression. But so they'll elongate something maybe, but it's really well done. And so your ear probably can't pick up on it. And I just know back in the day, they would just make, for me, they just made me do take after take because they didn't want to compress, they didn't want to elongate, so I was just constantly like screaming over and over.
It's
and
a
over.
Thousand times easier now.
Oh, so much easier now.
A thousand times
you get
easier.
You get a good engineer that they don't want you to do it a million times, they want to move on, and if they can compress it and it doesn't sound compressed, then they'll do it, and then you're on to the next cue.
Yeah, so but your voice is your voice. I mean, they don't usually alter.
Yeah.
Okay. Yeah, if he had a question, he could raise
his hand. Sure.
Anyway, what was your most memorable moments on sales on 2020? And also, have either of you ever mentioned any villains?
Villains?
Any villains on the show? Any villains on the
show? Oh, yeah.
What was the first question?
Have you had, what are your memorable experiences on sales?
Oh, okay.
Yeah, I can talk to you now. I think one of my, or my most memorable, I haven't been drinking this much. I've not met Lucy Christian before. I did Pony Pony Poemi, and Lucy and I had this lesbian scene in that show. And so I always talk about this, and I know she hates it, but she's not here. And doesn't matter. So, you know, we had this lesbian scene where it was raining and her character was in love with me. And so she's kind of trying to take advantage of me. And so I tell people, well, that's how I met Lucy Christian. And I would yell out, you know, I was on another show. And someone said, Lucy Christian is out in the hallway. And I was like, oh my gosh, that's my lesbian lover. And then I was like, shit, she was in there. Oh, I like, listen. I have children, I cuss all the time. So, you know, once I said that, then that kind of became my favorite scene because I would tell people, Lucy's my lesbian lover. That was before we met. I'm glad they never found her out in the hall because she would have been like, what is wrong with this woman? She's crazy. But that is one of my most memorable moments. And there was villains. I don't play villains because I sound like this. The only way my voice can get deeper is if I drink a lot of scotch and then I can't talk, so.
When I did Excel Saga, they brought me in for Pedro, and they said, okay, can you do a Mexican accent? And I said, well, it'll sound like, you know, Speedy Gonzalez, so no. And so they said,
that's not the only Mexican.
Well, I know that. It wouldn't sound like a real Mexican. It would sound like some stupid accent. And so they played around with the voices for a little bit, and he said, okay, so you know, this is what we did it for about 20 minutes, and I said, okay, why don't I just abandon it? So the accent you hear on that is not a Mexican accent. It is a dead solid, perfect impression of a waiter from a Greek restaurant that I used to go to. Have you ever been to Biba's once?
No.
There's a 60-year-old waiter there, and he's a complete, and he's the meanest waiter you'll ever meet. He's just a mean guy. He never takes your order. You know, what are you doing? No. And so I would do that impression, and they said, that's perfect, that's Pedro. And so it's not a Mexican accent, it's a Greek
it's
accent.
It's perfect, it's so perfect. Yeah, it's awesome.
Thank you.
You're awesome.
Thank you. Oh, and I had a lesbian scene too with with her.
You want to?
Yeah.
Who wouldn't? That was cut out.
I have this voice, so yes, I play villains all the time.
I have a lot of memorable experiences to draw upon from Excel Saga, but I think what I always think about when I worked on that show was the ending credits, which were so fast. And again, back then, they weren't using a lot of compression because you could really kind of tell when the compression was like, it sounded really sped up. I cannot tell you how many takes I did on the closing credits for each episode because it had to be perfect with flaps, blah, blah, blah. So I can remember just speaking so fast and hoping that it made sense and that it came out clear. And then I have nightmares about it. I don't know if you were kidding a minute ago, but no. Like my brain wouldn't shut down.
Yeah.
Because like I would do like 4-hour sessions. That's all I could really do. And then I would the next day I was on vocal rest and then I'd do another 4 hours the next day. So my sessions were pretty short. Because 4 hours is kind of a short, you know, because you can, I mean, now we do like 7-8 hour sessions in one day and that's a lot too. But for Excel Saga, it was 4 hours. And I would be done, but I would be like, for like the rest of the day. And I would try to sleep, and I didn't sleep well, because my brain was just on crack. So that's a happy thing. And as far as villains, no, I usually play just like psycho characters, or highly excitable, or little prey. But I don't think I've played an actual
villain.
I did. Do you know my work better than I do? I mean, I can put on a bit. Barbara! That was like one episode. Brett Weaver's like he's my best girlfriend. And Brett Weaver and I still laugh about that scene because he plays, what is his name?
Carrot.
He's Carrot. And I was Barbara, and we're like, oh, ew, our voices were in bed together. Ew, it's so gross! But anyway, yeah, so I guess I was a villain in that one episode.
You want to get it?
Have you guys ever met Nabishin?
I have not. Man, yeah, I have not met Nabishin.
I actually met him at ASA.
He's awesome, right?
He is awesome. He looks like that.
Yeah.
He actually dresses like that, and he kept slipping away from security. And he was perfectly fine because people thought he was a Nabishin cosplayer. And he also has a little Japanese woman that he takes with him, and he dresses up in various costumes that takes photographs for him and translates for him.
Is this a real person?
I know, that's exactly what I was thinking.
He's the real director.
No,
the little Japanese
person. Yeah, the Japanese, is it a puppet? Or is it a real person?
He's a real guy. He's the real name.
No, the Japanese woman.
Yeah, she's a real woman. She translates for him.
Oh, it's his translator, okay.
Because she said
yes, but it's a real woman.
Okay, but I'm having a disconnect here.
It's a real Japanese woman. You can buy them.
Woman.
I know to follow me around, I can address her.
Yeah,
it's safe.
It's Japanese woman, and he hired her as a translator, but he has her wear different outfits.
That's a prostitute.
Functions in that purpose.
Well, that's a prostitute. I think the point stands.
Australia?
Okay. Next.
Okay.
Yeah. Oh, yeah, you're good.
A couple of things, well, three things was, number one, in episode 26, like the last episode, I'd heard from like some internet critic, I'll let just say Bennett the Sage for the record, is that he had said that in the original Japanese version, they had said that there was a sarin gas attack that was referenced in that episode that had to be censored in Japan, but it's like, how did that work around itself in the U.S.? And then one of the other things was that when you're talking about nightmare fuel, I think the stuff would be like those little cute things that suddenly turn on Golo 13 on us. That just terrifying.
Can you be the Japanese woman and translate for me? I kind of got one.
You
out
here
did
understand.
Okay, repeat it.
All right, he said in the episode 26.
Yes.
There was a sarin gas attack.
Reference.
There was supposed to be a sarin gas attack.
Reference.
What's a sarin gas attack?
It was referenced. And they didn't do it in English, right? We didn't do it in English.
Well, they did. Well, yeah, I heard it. It wasn't in English, but it wasn't in the Japanese one because they censored.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Then, oh, I see what you're saying. Yeah.
And then one of the,
okay, I have no idea. To answer your question, I have no idea.
And then the second thing was, where do you guys think that XL landed when Il Palazzo dropped her into that bottomless pit?
Where'd you go? Hey, where'd you go?
Can't hear.
Are you, they said he dropped. They dropped you.
You mean when Excel fell in the trapdoor?
Yeah, like it happened like once an episode.
And
yeah,
what's your question about it? Though?
Where do you guys think she ended up?
I think here. Here. Like right here. Yeah, right here. I think she just went to a dark room and had to think about what she did for a while. That's what I think happened with that trapdoor.
Okay.
That's what I think.
Is there a gas attack that he's referring to? Is the Alshinrikyo attack, which is a cult that tried to attack the Tokyo subway, and they released sarin gas. It didn't end up going off, except for one.
Did it hurt people?
It hurt there.
Wow.
That's probably why they censored it.
Yeah.
Over there. That's why they ended up censoring a few episodes of Cowboy Bebop around 2001.
Okay. So,
because of
and you can't get it in Australia either. That's
well,
you can get you can't get S&M in Australia either. I don't want to go there. If I can't have S&M, I'm not going to go to your country and don't lose sleep.
Yeah, okay.
Yes,
okay.
Sir. Do you have a favorite line as Pedro? And if so, can you do it?
No.
do the waterfalls. Do the waterfalls. Like please. Yeah. Yes, you can. Yeah.
You can do it. You can
my
do it.
Dear. What?
We were counting on that.
Come on.
You were counting on that?
My
yeah, I know.
He said, yeah,
I know why, okay, this is hungover Pedro. My dear, I'm like, what the fuck? No! I get it here in a minute.
It's warm enough.
Thank you. Thank you. That's very kind. That'll be $100.
Where's our tip jar?
Koshi Rikto, the
writer?
The manga?
Yeah. What?
You meant the writer.
Oh, no.
No.
We don't ever meet them. Yeah. Once it's done in Japan, they send it over to us, and we never get to meet the original.
Unless they're at conventions.
Yeah, unless they're at conventions.
Not Shane goes to the conventions, but no, we haven't met. We could go over.
Have you read the manga?
No.
No! I'm just gonna answer every question like that.
Yes.
Yes.
Ms. Cavilla, I thank you for coming back again this year. I missed you last year, and I was so excited. So thank you guys for coming.
Oh, thank you. I know I was all ready to come last year, and then I caught the plague. I was so sick. Like, I was unbelievably sick, and so yeah, I had to cancel the last minute. I hated doing that. So. Thank you, and it's wonderful to actually be here. My parents are like waterfalls. I mean, yeah! So, your question. Really? Oh my God. Bravo start tap dancing.
What do you think is your favorite line for each one of you? What's your favorite line you've ever said, and your worst line?
Worst line.
Oh God.
There's a lot of worst.
So many worsts.
Yeah, there's a lot of worst. The worst stuff is when they get very technical and they have a lot of technical jargon that actually does not make sense, but they have to make it sound like it makes sense.
Yeah.
And that's the worst when they give you that. That and I don't speak Japanese, and so
really,
yeah, I know, shocking. Whenever they give you the Japanese, this is the funniest story I've ever heard. Okay, there was one. The name escapes me, but it was like gangsters. It was like mafia, but it was set in outer space. Okay, and so they had mafia in outer space, and I came in. I was like the fourth or fifth person to read. So everybody else had done their lines, right? And so I get in there, and one of the things we called the crime family was called the La Familia, right? That's La Familia. That's what they call. That's what the mafia call. It's La Familia.
I know, I'm Italian.
Yeah. Okay. Anyway.
Everybody else before me had read La Familia as La Famiglia.
Oh, God!
They used it, it was La Famiglia, right?
Yeah.
And so everybody out of it, so I got in there and they said, oh, I'm proud to be part of La Familia. And the director just goes,
could you say that again, please?
I went, La Familia.
He's like, oh, Jesus Christ. That's how you say it, isn't it? No way.
Yeah, that's how you say it. Goes,
oh, God. We got 7 hours of people saying La Famiglia. You're going to have to say La Famiglia. I said, that's the dumbest thing I've ever heard.
Call everybody back in. So the crime family became La Famiglia. And it was the stupidest thing. So that's the worst thing I ever had to say.
That's great.
Oh, I should use this. Sorry. I don't know. You know, the only thing is that I do have a bit of an accent, and
no.
I just, I know none of y'all knew I was Mexican before I said it, but
we thought you were Greek.
It's true. Same difference. Same difference. Because Spanish is my first language, and there are times when that comes out. And so I think the one word that I had to repeat over and over and over, bless you, over and over and over again on one show was pianist, because I can't, or the producer thought I was a penis.
That's science, you can say that.
Okay, I thought penis. But I... Pianist, but I would say pianist. So anyhow, that's how I say it, and I guess that was my Latin accent coming out, and so I think I had to say it a couple of times. They finally said, this is how you say it, and I was like, I'm not dumb, I know.
He was a 6-foot pianist.
So anyhow, next.
Yeah. So there's actually... one of my favorite lines was from Excel Saga, and I forget which episode. I think it's in the third volume, where she gorges herself on hot dogs. And in the original Japanese, Katona Mitsubishi, you know, like Excel's like looking back to the camera, and she goes, "Oh, I'm sexy." And so, you know, in the script it said I'm sexy, and I'm like, I don't want to say I'm sexy, because I mean, it's so funny the way she does it. She's just so amazing. And so Matt's like, well, just do it like her. So, I mean, it took like 9 or 10 takes because we kept laughing. But yeah, I finally was like, whoa, I'm a sexy. So it did stay in, and it was awesome.
Racist.
No, it wasn't racist. I wasn't trying to act like a Japanese person or be an Asia. I was emulating Katono. Why you got a front, man?
I don't know.
Intro.
That's just the Famiglia.
Yeah, racist. As an Italian, I'm offended at your love. Yeah. Famiglia. Yeah. I mean, that's
the
just...
The Famiglia is in the back of your throat. That's where you get tonsils or something.
Wow, that's
where
you get... Anyway.
I pulled my Famiglia and I played football.
You sure did.
I have a 12-foot pianist, too. I'm stuck to move a piano. That's my Famiglia.
Ooh, you are sexy.
Moments in the booth, yeah, where you're going, oh my God, if I have to say this one more time. Or just something that's not fitting and you have to make it fit because you don't have a choice. So I bet I can't think of a particular story.
Here's a funny inside the actor's bed here. They put you in the little booth, right? It's a very small room, sound booth with the microphone.
Padded.
Right, it's all padded, right? And they have like, it's padded so to absorb sound, but they have this... It's very absorbent, right? This material, whatever it is. Here's a fun thing to do. As soon as you're done, you fart really loud. And then you leave and shut the door. And that'll stay in there.
That was you?
And so the next person who comes in, they're like, what the Jesus? I think that's just fun. I think it's fun. It's fun. Yeah, pretty much, yeah.
Weeks!
They gotta
also disturbing.
Yeah. Oh, yes.
Okay, so you keep mentioning tap dancing.
I don't know how to tap dance.
He does. He does. Yeah, he knows how. He's really shy. Do a little jazz hand.
There he goes.
I'll hold your pianist. Oh, I gotta
stop. Whoa, wait. 1 second here.
Ta-da! 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 Ta-da. Wait, why are you behind the chairs? Ta-da! Ta-da!
That's it.
Behind the chairs.
I also arm wrestle professionally.
Anyone else?
Arm wrestle.
Yes.
Well, nowadays, you know how they like to re-release older series. And, will they consider ever bringing back like the Excel Saga cast to redo stuff, or maybe add additional information to the DVDs?
That is a good question. I don't know. It depends on who has the rights now, and it's up to them whether they want to do that or not. So that's a business thing we have no control over. But if they call me, I'll happily go talk like a drink waiter again. I don't care.
Question. Oh. Yes.
What was it like trying to gather enough energy for all the monologues praising old blocks?
Yeah. Excel Saga was definitely the highest energy role I've ever had. Hanji's pretty high energy too, but she also has her moments of drama and darkness, but yeah, Excel does not shut up. neither does Kaneko from Reaholic. She's another one. You know what I did? This is what I did. I would have a tea, a hot tea to soothe my cords, and then I would have a water that was also kind of warm because I don't drink anything cold in the studio because it tightens up my cords, and then I would have Skittles. And then some hockey. I swear to God, I took a picture of it at some point. Like, this is how I, to keep my sugar up. And I can't eat like that or drink all that caffeine anymore because then it's bad sugar crash. But when you're young, you can do those things. So anyway, I would sort of have all those things going on and it would keep my energy up. And then by the end of 4 hours, I was just like, night-night, bye-bye. So.
I smoke a pack of cigarettes and drink some scotch.
How much all?
Yeah, so 9 in the morning.
And farts.
On you. A lot. And have an egg sandwich.
Wow.
And then I go about my business.
Aside from Excel Saga, what would you say is some of the favorite or some of the work that you enjoyed doing the best?
Ghost
like
stories for me. I'm a jock. That was probably one of my favorites. Yeah. Stephen Foster. Yes. That was probably my favorite. And anytime we get to play a demon, I love that. I will rip your soul apart, you evil bastard.
Did they affect your voice in that? No. Awesome.
They
awesome.
Don't have to. I haven't gotten given. Well, 8 billion years of evolution.
You haven't gotten given a lot of things.
Which one?
The dog's
the
only
thing they've Yeah, pretty much. The ghost stories? Yeah. And pretty much the script was thrown out.
Yeah.
That's another one we just said, okay, screw it. We'll just. You know, there's an unreleased thing. There's we did a Gamera, and we did a like a redneck version. We did redneck voices on it. But we also did. There was another anime we did, which we came in on a weekend, and we all just got drunk and did redneck voices for all the Japanese characters. I can't remember. It was unreleased. If it ever gets released, it's hysterical. It is cry funny. Cry funny. Just here to see the Japanese guy. Tell you what, man, I'm going to go down there. Big old turtle, man. I'm going to go down there. I'm going to call that man. Got a missile line around here? Yeah, you got a missile. Yeah, good. The NRA, man. You got a missile. Go down to the gun show, man. Get a gun. Shoot that turtle. It's that for now. Hilarious. Somewhere on the shelf. I'm sorry. I think they should do a Mexican dub.
I think that they should. I think all my accents could come out, but one I have.
As much as it's a
Mexican. You're Mexican?
Pedro coming out.
But you need to call him Pedro.
That's not how the Greeks pronounce it.
True.
You gotta know my backstory. This is why the Dutch are, don't know the backstory.
I think probably my favorite, I don't know, I don't have a favorite, but I liked voicing Lena from Slayers because she was mean, but she could still be cute, and I don't get to play mean characters a lot because I sound like this, so I liked playing her because I got to actually blow people up and be mean to people, and you know, so I would say that's probably one of the voices that I really liked, or the, you know, and then I really liked Voices of a Distant Star just because it was so dramatic and it was a beautiful story. I have a lot of ones that I really like, so, but I like being mean. I like playing mean characters.
I really have enjoyed working on Attack on Titan as Hanji. It's been really awesome. But I really like a lot of the earlier stuff I did. A favorite of mine is Fam from Ruin Explorers, which is like, I think it's a really underrated show. It's 4 episodes only. And
Fam was half wigging, half squirrel, and she talked like this.
And it was one of the few times I was able to actually like do something different with my voice, and like, which is kind of annoying, but it was still really fun. It's a really cute story. So I really enjoyed working on a lot of the earlier stuff too. So yeah.
What are you working on right now? All of you.
I'm working on taking a picture.
I get distracted easily.
I just completed another season of One Piece. Oh, thank you. Which is actually, that voice is probably, it's the same as Pedro's, really, I think. It's the same voice.
You have a bad Mexican accent? All the time.
No. No.
Wow.
It's between One Piece and...
That's pretty awesome.
Just one octave. That'll be $100.
$100.
And I'm actually, I do stand-up, and I'm actually recording myself and 3 other comics. We're called the Whiskey Brothers, and we're recording a Netflix special in February.
Awesome. Yeah. And where's that going to be done?
In Houston, Texas.
What venue, in case we want to go?
Warehouse Live. Tickets are available.
Warehouse Live.
Tickets available online if you're in the Houston area on February 21st.
February 21st. What is the name of the show? It hasn't been formally announced, but it's already on like all the social media, so I can talk about it. But what's the name of it? Chris Ayers directed it. Goddesses are in the title. Is it the World God?
Yes, the World God only knows that.
The World. Are you in
Goddess? Are
okay. We can't talk about it.
When you said goddess, I was like, oh, I know
that. Yeah, the World God only knows. So that they haven't like formally like released the cast list, but it's out there. So I'm Hakwa. Who are you in that?
I don't.
Okay. I couldn't remember who I was. I'm like, oh my goodness. So, but currently, I'm not working on a anime right now. I'm kind of trying to do more singing. I have a really bad YouTube channel. And when I say bad, I've just thrown a couple of parodies up there. I've worked with Team 4-Star before. I played Rip Van Winkle in episode 4 of Hellsing Ultimate Abridged. Had so much fun working with Curtis and Scott. If you've ever seen a Team 4-Star parody dub, they're amazingly, wonderfully talented, and they're so nice. And we had so much fun recording that. And from that, I went ahead and I recorded the full version in a very bad German accent singing Never Gonna Give You Up. It's terrible. Just go to it, listen to 2 beats, and turn it off, because it's supposed to be bad, and hopefully it's so bad, it's like Showgirls bad. It's so bad, it's good. That's what I was going for. And then, but I have recorded something new, and it's in the final mixing stages, and I can't wait for it to be released, but it's just not ready yet, so that's all I got.
So I was working on The World God Only Knows as well, but I also sing and write, and so right now what I'm focusing on is a lot of my music stuff. I'm also working on a screenplay with a couple of other people. We have this whole Latin movement thing that's trying to move into Hollywood, and so we're trying to do this whole, you know, so we're working on a movie, first a screenplay for a movie, and just kind of trying to bring, you know, Latin people into Hollywood. And so I write for different bands in Texas. They have these things, these bands called the Hano bands. So I write for them, I write songs for them, and I also have my own band that I sing with. So that's keeps me busy. And
I'm also
kids.
Recording a Tejano album as well.
I know, I write for Rob.
As Pedro.
we do a Spanish version, we're never going to give you up.
It's so girl bad.
Yeah, it's awful.
Yeah.
The accordion, right?
Yeah.
It's true.
Anyone else?
My
foreign accents are horrible. They're generally bad. In fact, there's a guy in Norway who created a website saying Rob's foreign accents suck.
You're kidding.
He wrote a whole blog about how my voice acts.
In Norway?
They sound like they're eating spaghetti all the time. The whole language is based on nothing. I don't know what they're oodlots. What the hell is that? What is that for? You got three U's in your name. What is that? That's not a language. That's a, you lost at Scrabble. That's what that is. So this little bastard, you have nothing better to do than create a website devoted to how I suck. Here's a great drinking game. Every time he does a bad Russian accent, take a drink. You'll be screwed up and like... You'll be messed up, and then 15 minutes of this particular episode, shut up.
Wow. Amazing. Yeah. You need to share that website.
And I don't know if it's still up. It was like 6 years ago.
I'm going to Google me too. That's funny. Someone in Norway. You upset someone in Norway with your accent. That's power, Rob.
You know, if you can reach just one person.
Right. Australia is really far.
Right. My dominatrix stuff in Australia, but some kid in Norway can talk bad about me. Damn you, internet!
That's crazy.
Anything else? Yeah.
Who do you think is more hyper, Mink or XL?
Mink or XL? Which one is more hyper? I think the hyper might be the same. I think XL though is crazy, and I don't think Mink is crazy. I think Mink is maybe a little off, but not like psycho. So, I think hyper-wise, I think they're both pretty hyper, right? I think so. Don't you think? Yeah.
And why aren't you in the Team 4-star Attack on Titan?
Yeah, why aren't you?
Yet.
Yes.
Yet.
Okay.
All I can say. Okay.
Question.
Go ahead. Yeah.
This is to Rob Mungle specifically on your performance of Pedro. There was this whole like skit going on in the Excel episodes that was like distant from Excel's and Hyatt's and
right.
Il Palazzo's plot going on, where like Pedro had to face Gomez to reclaim his sexy wife or whatever,
yes.
And then the will of the macrocosm comes out of nowhere, and then there's this twist that Gomez is actually that man who was previously, like, what was your opinion on that? Did that like crack you up, or did you?
I was drunk the whole time, I have no idea.
Drunk and gassy.
I have the foggiest head.
Oh. But a follow-up on that, did you get the little reference with the whole Afro power thing going on, which had similarities to DBZ?
No.
Aww.
I thought he was black when I first saw him. I thought he was a black guy. I did.
Aww.
Okay. Yeah.
Jessica, once you injured your voice, how hard is it to recover from that sort of injury?
Well, I pretty much injure my voice with nearly every voice project I do. So, all I do is I go on just strict vocal rest for a few days, and I'm good to go. So the recovery time really isn't too long.
Pure whiskey.
Pure whiskey.
Yeah.
And a little bit of cocaine. Yeah. I'm just kidding. Just kidding. Don't do cocaine.
If you take honey and whiskey. And you drink it, and you can get it. It really does work well. And if you don't have any honey, the whiskey works just fine. In fact, don't even bother with the honey.
Actually, when I do when I do when I
my voice is a little scratchy, I can't do any alcohol at all because it dehydrates me and it makes it worse. So are you kidding with the whiskey?
No.
Me either.
I won't drink at all. No wine, no anything. You garlic. It's crazy. I just do a lot of hot water and I do a lot of steaming, you know, sucking in the fumes. And
you don't get this voice from drinking milk, let me tell you. It's just eight cartons of cigarettes a day.
And then do you smoke?
Oh, God, yes, all the time.
Do you smoke?
Pot? No.
Do you smoke?
No, officer, I don't.
By the military.
Yeah.
Usually the best thing to do is just stay quiet.
Yeah,
don't talk.
Don't use your voice. Yeah, and during Excel Saga, I actually didn't speak at all. I had a notepad, which I'd saved for a long time. And I literally, I'm not even kidding you, but I did not speak when I wasn't on mic, because that part was so vocally challenging, obviously. And then between each volume, I was supposed to have a certain amount of rest, which didn't happen. And so that's why when I finally came back to record the fourth volume, they'd only given me a 2-week break, and they were supposed to give me 6 weeks, because that's what we'd agreed to, but it didn't happen. So you can only push so far, and your vocal cords are two little bit tissues.
Yeah.
And so I had them examined and looked at, and they were in bad shape. And so, you know, that's the way that goes. You really do have to take care of yourself.
Did you have the camera put up your nose?
I had the camera.
Yeah,
I had the camera put. He put this numbing nasal stuff up your nose. It was horrible. And then he lit a match, and I was like, ah!
Wait, what kind of doctor did you go to?
That's a prostitute.
Well,
was she a little Japanese woman?
What's really funny is I thought I was my gynecologist. And I was like, what is wrong with that match?
Somebody's got a match in here. Look at this.
God, was Rob Mungle in here? Jesus, cavernous. So it was a vocal specialist, and he's like, yeah, you need to stop whatever it is you're doing, or you're going to give yourself permanent damage. So that's what happened.
Yeah, so really the best thing is to just rest your voice
and give it
speak.
Time.
Give it time.
Yeah.
Yeah. So.
We have time for a couple more.
Sorry.
Is it common for voice actors to have a special doctor for their vocal cords? When do you know you have to go? How do you know you're doing damage?
I use a gynecologist.
Thank God.
Yeah.
We're going to talk to you about that.
Yeah. No, not really.
But you know how
if
you don't have vocal cords?
I think you can always tell when you're doing damage because it doesn't feel good. You know, I mean, for me, because I'm a vocalist and because I do the voice work, I can tell. I mean, you can tell. There's like this little unnatural tingling type feeling.
If I'm more than 2 hours in the studio, it'll start to flag a little bit.
Yeah.
And I'm like, okay,
you can feel it. Yeah, you can feel it. And you can feel the exhaustion, and you can tell in your voice that you're tired. So,
after 2 hours?
Yeah, after about two hours, I get. And then
if you can only go for 2 hours, I can go for 8. You know what I mean?
What do you mean?
That's a prostitute. Again, I don't even tell you how to live your life.
Look,
this
my gynecologist
we're gonna put a name on it. You know.
My gynecologist says I'm fine. No, okay. I'm just kidding.
That's outstanding.
I'm really not fine.
It's true.
It's really true.
So one more?
One more.
Okay. If your character, like say, like except old Pedro and you know whatever, had the power to like go into a different world, go into an anime world where one of you voiced a certain character, like say Pedro went into the world of Needless or Excel went into the world of Attack on Titan, how would they affect that world and how would they interact with that character?
Can you imagine if Excel went into the world of Attack on Titan? I mean, what would happen? I don't believe it. Wow, I've never thought about that before. My goodness. What? She would be starving. God, that would be hilarious. I don't know. She'd just probably start singing and try to play with the Titans and somehow escape death. I don't know how, but she's Excel, so she'll escape anything. Unless there's a trap door, and she'll be in there for a while. That's a great thought, though. What do you guys think?
I would put him in the ghost stories and let the cat scratch his eyes out.
No.
Hey, don't laugh at me. I've never seen it.
It's fun. Yeah, it's fun.
Okay, well, my life is a comedy.
I do. Yeah, it's Scooby-Doo. It's a rip-off of Scooby-Doo.
Okay,
yeah, kind of.
Hey,
yeah.
Scooby-Doo scared me when I was younger.
Yeah, and I play a cat who can talk, and he's like demon-possessed. And it's a very bad Jack Nicholson impression. But that's what they said. They said, we want it to sound like Jack Nicholson. And I said, well, I do a bad one. And they said, okay, that's perfect. Every voice I do is a variation. It's true. I do bad impersonations, but they work great in anime. I do like a bad George Clooney, and it works perfectly for one character I did. It's fabulous. If you can do bad, oh yeah, no, yes. Oh, we have to wrap it up.
Cynthia.
I just want to be Excel, so whatever she says, that's
what.
My girl. That is my character. My girl.
Thank you all for coming out.